Welcome to episode 7 of Lesbian Training for Men. As in the words of the great band Devo, the name of this episode is, Are We Not Men? Now, I could say, no, I'm not a man. And that's the truth, I'm not. But in a general sense, there are two chromosomal genders on this planet. And while identification is a completely different topic and story, what I would start this with is, are we not human? And thinking of the human race being broken down into two chromosomal genetic dispositions, we are generally satisfied in knowing that one genetic disposition has both a hormonal and perhaps conditioned, by and large, reaction to the environment around one, and the other one as well, in a sort of, in some different ways, to certain degrees. And while most of us do not spend time wondering how we can get a cat to act like a dog, or a dog to act like a cat, or even how we can get a cat to do anything, because cats really don't seem to think they answer to anyone, why we don't spend our time trying to get kangaroos to act like sea turtles, why don't we have conversations about why bald eagles don't act like a crocodile? I think the farthest that that all goes is when we see books or pictures of animals that sort of adopt other animals into their brood or make time to be kind to another animal. No doubt there is some sort of cognitive or conscious reaction to certain situations with animals. Indeed. And yet, somehow we spend a lot of time wanting to reshape, reset, modify, and in fact mutate so much of our humanity. And for the intents and purposes of this presentation, I'm talking specifically about men. I was having a conversation with a friend, and we were going on about how difficult it is, perhaps, as far as we can imagine, to be a male in this environment today. What with the being shamed of acting upon your genetically male impulses to protect your family, to protect those around you, in anything ranging from protecting your family, protecting those around you, to looking at something with a specific kind of logic instead of at first having overwhelmingly strong emotions about it. Now, again, I've said this again and again. This doesn't mean that there isn't some sort of scale through which people have different reactions, whether they are emotional or physical. Indeed, there is a scale and a range for everything, whether someone is talking about the female species or the male. And yet, what I find very disconcerting in this world that we say is so accommodating and liberal and diverse is the question I have, which I want to expand on this question more and more, and that is, says who? Because most of the time, what one person thinks is lenient or accepting, there are so many others that disagree with what those definitions are, that sometimes it's very difficult to come to any sort of modicum about what would be an even acceptable gradation through which to analyze what is in front of us, let alone come to conclusions about how what is in front of us should behave, react, or respond. During this conversation with my friend, she said, "Would you let people know that it's okay for men to be men?" Yes, I think that not only is it okay for men to be men, but it's very important for all of us to understand that there is such a thing as a man and what makes him up and what his general propensities are and how those play into the strengths of society, family, friendships, and relationships. And sometimes I think that in this world of hypersensitivity to perceived offenses, that it is very shocking to me that simply being as a man would be an offense that is not only taken by some, but also used as a justification to punish or abuse those of the male gender. I once heard Dennis Miller, I think he was interviewing Adam Carolla. They were going on about a rap star that had gotten onto a plane and he was asked to turn off his cell phone. And while that is an expectation for everyone who gets on a plane and it's beginning its takeoff into the air, this particular person claimed that he was being asked to turn off his cell phone because the stewardess was a racist. And after kind of throwing this story back and forth a little bit, Adam Carolla said, you know, that most of the time people are not racist, they are just jerks. And he substantiated this by saying that if there ever was a time in human history, particularly in our country, to actually be a racist and blend in with everyone else, it was now. Because no matter what you say, or no matter what you do, if racism is going to be pinned on you as your motivation for saying whatever you're saying, then it doesn't really matter what you say, and you could be hiding in plain sight as a racist. Because if everything is being said to be white supremacy or racism, then there is no differentiation, and therefore, how can you even begin to qualify what is going on or quantify it so that there is some solution that can be had to create that which is the resolve that everybody says they want, which is diversity, peace, and cooperation amongst people. What we know is that there's an enormous amount of money, of attention, of control that is to be had by never solving the problem. And in fact, the ingenuity that has been placed into perpetuating the problem has been enormous as of late. And so when I think of how men are being blamed for everything from male toxicity to unending misogyny and irrefutable dominance, it seems to me that there is no discussion of what it is to be human, and thus a discussion of what it is to be a man constructively at this time. This is a very strange phenomenon, because once you realize why, in fact, a man or the male species could be the object and the target of overt aggression against him, then what one must realize is that all of the effort and the focus on doing that is simply an effort to remove one of the big cornerstones of protecting the family against that which is perhaps unwanted, undesired, and definitely needing some protecting against. And so as we come to some of these understandings about how the universe works through its polarity, what we find is that removing one part or one half of the polarity has disastrous effects, both socially, economically, spiritually, mentally, physically, and I would say even down to our safety environmentally. I don't think that the real enemy here is men being violent or men being aggressive. I think the real problem is when you perpetuate the idea that there is a species on our planet that is unacceptable to the point of denigration, compromise on their dignity and their self-worth and their human personal sovereignty. There is nothing that happens to one half of the population that is not going to affect the other half. And so as we see all of the ill effects of divorces and diminishing male presence in the home, we can absolutely correlate that to the ever-growing evidence of how it is connected to crime, unhappiness, and a dimming of how we identify on what it is to be human. Again, as in the words of Devo, are we not men? Well, not all of us. I mean, as women, no, we are not men. But this does not excuse all of us from this issue that is growing in our society of the demonization of one gender that makes up half of the population and will be the examples, the mentors, and the models for the next consciousness to come into that gender on the planet. Let's all of us take a moment for this tip of the day to at least consider not just how much weaker we will be as a civilization if we do not encourage and strengthen the male species on the planet, but how much more of an amazing and resilient existence that we could make possible if we do.